So my name is Kevin. You've already met Jim, my father. This is Dorothy.
Yeah.
And there's a test at the end with names. So does anybody need a note paper, notepad?
No problem, Frank.
Okay.
I'm going to watch the
Frank. Mr. Frank.
This is Frank.
This is Frank. I like that. All right. So welcome to Bovano. For those of you that don't know, we make enameled sculptures here. So all of our pieces are made out of three different materials. They start with either, most of them are made out of copper. So our copper is very, very similar. It's almost identical to roofing copper, which is what they make copper gutters out of and downspouts and all that kind of thing. This is a 16-ounce 110 alloy copper. I'll pass this around. We don't have any kids here. So it has sharp edges on it. So just don't cut yourself. And then we also use a little bit of brass as well. So you can see the color difference between brass and copper here. You can just see it, obviously. But if you want to feel, it is a little bit heavier. And this is all, the brass is also a lot stiffer as well. Yeah. And then we also use a little bit of stainless steel. Okay. So you'll see in some of our sculptures that we use stainless steel also. The next thing that we do is, and we're going to talk about this because it doesn't happen in this building, is we cut our parts out, okay? We're going to spend a couple of minutes on this because it's very important. We use a process called chemical milling, which is also called photo etching. So I'm going to go fast here, so stop me if you have any questions. The way that we cut the parts, so this is obviously some parts in a blank of brass. Most of them, like I said, are cut out of copper. A piece of blank like that is actually coated with what's called a chemical resist, okay? And then a tool, a digital tool, this is the actual tool that goes with this one here, okay? Is actually imposed onto the chemical resist that was loaded, okay, that was printed on top of this piece of metal. Everybody with me? Okay? So it's almost like it was like a camera that was printed on top of this. Okay? It's done in a dark room. Then what happens is that it's exposed on here, and the image of the parts is hardened. That resist material is hardened on the top of here. And all of the lines that you see are not hardened and are rinsed off. So what you're left with is a hard material on top of here, and you're left with the brass showing where the lines are. Okay? With me? Then what happens is this material runs through a chemical milling machine, and the chemicals eat away at the lines. Okay? So this is what you're left with, is all of the brass has been cut out. Okay? Got it? So that's pretty cool, because you can cut parts out like this. So people say, well, why don't you use water jet, or why don't you use a laser or something like that? Well, the reason being is that those only cut a single point at a time. So if I was to cut this with a water jet, it would go like this, right? It cut this out first, then it would cut this out first, then it would cut this out, right? It only cut a single point at a time. With chemical milling, you can cut the whole sheet all at one time. The other thing about chemical milling is you can do this. And you can do what's called a half etch. So if you look at the outside of this, we've actually only cut halfway through the copper. Okay? So I'll pass this around. You guys want to start that? Go ahead, guys. So what a half etch does, that you can't do with any other thing, is we can put veins into things. Okay? So we can put veins into tree trunks. We can put veins into our leaves. Okay, so that adds a tremendous amount of detail. We can put veins into our dragonflies. Okay, so we'll pass some of this stuff around so you guys can see them. So that really adds a tremendous amount of detail into all of our pieces.
That I like. Yeah, and
awesome?
Yeah, that piece of coral.
I didn't see anything in this showroom, but I always it's in the coral pot.
It's by the fish.
By the fish.
Yeah.
Okay, because I was going to
say. That really shows off. So imagine on this piece of coral. Let me just see this for a second. Imagine a laser or a water jet cutting this out. Imagine every little point, how long that would take. And if they charge you by the hour, there's no way, right?
You couldn't afford your pieces.
Exactly right. So that's why we use chemical milling. It's a very similar process to how they do circuit boards, actually. Okay? So all of our parts have been cut out. Oh, let me finish passing this around. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to steal it off you guys. Once all of our parts are cut out, they now have to be shaped. So every single part that comes to us to be shaped goes into this machine, and every single one is shaped one at a time. So what Dorothy's going to show you now, as you're watching her, is she is shaping dogwood petals. So she's going from a flat petal to a shaped petal like this. You guys see that? Yeah? All right, she's going from a flat one. So what she has is a mold that we've made here. Okay, so there's a rack right here. Oh, I'm sorry, yeah. This shelving here is all molds that we made here ourselves. Okay. Shaped to copper. Yeah. So it's gone from that to that. So, copper, as you guys know, is very soft, so it does not take a lot of pressure in order to put shape into a copper.
That same machine does the bigger?
That same machine does everything. Yeah, it does everything here, from big shapes down to little parts. So then what happens is, you want to switch? Okay, we do this every tour. You ready? So then what happens is we're going to make all of, in this case we're making a dogwood flower. We're going to make all of those parts into a flower. So what we're going to do is we're going to mechanically fasten all of those parts together. So just like a flower in Mother Nature, we have a stem, right? We have our petals that we just shaped, okay? We're going to have a stamen. So as I'm calling them out, you see Dorothy's loading them up onto this part here. Puts the petal on, and then at the very end she's going to put on a little brass rivet. Okay, so she's threaded all of those onto the stem one at a time. Listen, it's been a long morning. I only had one cup of coffee. So I'm going to pass some of these out. If you look very carefully on the floor, you might even see a couple of them. Alright, so if you look carefully, these are all the parts that are required to make, not all of those, but just one of those. Can you guys see those back there? Okay? No, she's not going to stop them. She's going to smash them. She's going to smush them. It's a really technical term, okay? Smushing. Okay?
Do you wear gloves when she's working here?
We do not wear gloves, no. Because these parts are so little that if you were to wear gloves, you could not feel them at all. See that? Dorothy. I can't wear quicker gloves for these. So. All right, so now get ready for the smushing. So what Dorothy's going to do is, she has a little mini jackhammer. And what she's done is she has now pushed all of those parts down on top of that little rivet. So all of those parts are now sitting right on top of that rivet. Go ahead. So now, within a millisecond, they've all been smushed on top of that rivet. So we'll pass this around. Go ahead, you want to make a couple more? Here. You guys can take that one and pass it that way. And maybe it'll come down that way. So now we've made a dogwood flower. So before they're done, we'll actually take a little pair of pliers like this, and we'll take the middle stamen and we'll squeeze all the little parts together to hide the brass ribbon. So we'll actually take this, we'll take that, and we'll center it up to hide. So you can imagine how much time it takes
to do this.
So you see how it's open in the center? It will actually close up every single one. So eventually what's going to happen, the end result, is we're going to take the copper one and we're going to put glass on it and turn it into this. Okay? Got it? Okay. Any questions so far? There's no silly questions, unless you laugh at them.
I want to hear that bad joke.
That was the first one.
Pretty bad.
What determines whether you use the brass, the stainless, or the copper?
All of the parts that get glass on them are copper. We use the brass and the stainless as ornamental parts later on, just to get different colorations on some of the pieces. So, but we use, that's why 99% of what we do is copper. So we do about...
Is the glass put on the other also?
No, glass is only put on top of the copper. So we do about 200 pounds of copper a week. So.
Is it an adhering component? Or
it is, yeah. Yeah, the glass that we use, the term, people hear the word enamel, and they think, well, I buy enamel paint, right? It says you go to Lowe's and it says enamel paint on it and that kind of stuff. So we use glass enamel. Some people think the word enameling is the process of applying something onto something else. To me, we use a hard glass enamel. Other people think enamel like, oh, well, I bought this pin and it has liquid enamel in it. Well, I don't know what liquid enamel is, you know. So I think it gets misused sometimes. These white bins over here are all enamel to me. They're glass enamel. It's been purchased. I should also mention that we purchase our glass from France. It's imported from Limoges, France, which is the China capital of the world. We also have a second manufacturer that's in the U.S., so those are the two places in the world. There's only one other company that's in Japan that you can buy this particular product from. So, but the word enameling gets used differently sometimes. Some people get confused. They say, oh, you're using enamel paint. And I say, no, it's glass enamel. So if you've met me at a show, you've probably heard me say, oh, it's glass over copper. It's glass enamel. I'm constantly using the word glass. This is tubs of glass that's been taken out of a glass kiln and then ground down to a powder. That's exactly what it is. We then shake it over copper, refire it into a glass surface again. So, okay? Okay. So we're going to go over... Crazy. So we're going to go over and see how they put the glass on top of the surface of the copper next, okay? So what we're going to do is let you guys kind of walk through, and then we're going to end up at the kiln and show you how we fire everything over there, okay? Follow me, we're going to go over this way. So, this is Fong. We're going to watch Fong here. So, Fong's actually making a bird called a cedar waxwing. Sharon's busy, so we have to watch you. Okay. So what she's doing is she's using different stencils, and she's putting one stencil on, and then she's putting a little bit of the glass powder on, and then she takes that stencil off, and she puts a different stencil on, and shakes a little bit of glass powder on. So it essentially becomes a paint by number system. So, and after she finishes, so what she's done actually, she's put a, I'm gonna borrow one of these, okay? She's put a base coat of a white color on the front, okay? On the back, this gray is actually all of our leftover glass, okay? So we put a glass on the back for two reasons. Number one, it covers the copper on the back so it doesn't oxidize when we put it into the kiln. It gets rid of some of our waste so we don't have to throw it out. And also, when the glass in the front expands when it goes into the kiln, it also the glass in the back will expand at the same rate, so it doesn't flex the copper. It's about a expansion coefficient.
Can you show that? Yeah.
Sure. There you go. Okay. So then what she does is she fires this as a base coat, okay? The next step is to put all the colors on. Now this is a cedar waxwing. This is actually a really beautiful bird. So this is what the birds, this is our sample. It has a broken foot, but it's just a sample. This is what it's going to look like when it's finished, okay? So you can see she has one here finished that it's just in the powder form now. When it gets fired in the kiln, it's going to look like this.
What's the temperature though, the kiln?
Just under 1600. So we're gonna fire something after so we can show you, okay?
How does it stick on there?
That's a very good question. I'll show you in this next booth over here. This is Dorothy's booth. So what we do is we spray on a sticky powder, or a sticky water. And the water has a little bit of stick to it. It's just like if you were to get your hand wet and stick it into the sand, okay? But what we have to do is that before we fire, that water's gotta dry 100%. Because if you were to take that water and then stick it into the kiln, that water would evaporate instantly. So we have to make sure that all the water's dried first. So the water helps us to have the glass stick to the top of the piece, but the water has to evaporate before we put it into the kiln. So you'll see there's a couple of owls over there drying before it goes into the kiln. All right, so we're gonna have, probably have Sharon come over and fire those for you, okay? So I'm gonna have you guys go on the other side of where the two yellow chains are over there, okay? It's, they're called, So the two snowy owls are gonna go in. If Fong fires it, then I can talk, so. So what you'll notice is that they're very powdery now, but when they come out, they're gonna be nice and smooth and glassy. So the kiln's at 1575, it's just under 1600. And it's gonna fire in there for 70 seconds. Anybody have any questions I can answer in under 70 seconds?
What happened if it waited 75 seconds?
75 is okay. If it goes any longer than that, it looks like this. It cooks for too long. This is what happens when you go on lunch and you leave it in.
So you keep that stove on all day?
That one?
Yeah.
Stays on all day long.
How much stuff is in there?
Not that much, believe it or not. It's, I don't know, it's just part of doing business. You just pay the bills, you know? So, if somebody asked me how much does it cost to run, and we've been paying for electric kilns for so many years. I've never put an amp meter on it and figured it out, to be honest. So we used to run three of them. So
in more than one setup, did you have like three different trays in there?
No, you can only have one. When I was a kid, when we used to really crank, we used to have three kilns, and that we used to have a firing job, and we used to fire three at a time. So you'll see as this piece cools off, it'll slowly turn from yellow and it'll get brighter. It'll look like this on the bottom when it's cool.
How long does that take?
You'll see it turn white in about a minute here. But you'll notice that it's gone from that powdery color to a nice, clear, smooth coating on top. Yeah, we used to be a much larger operation, so. A piece like this is two firings. It can go in and out as many times as we need it to. Like if we found that the eyes weren't dark enough, we could add some more glass to it and fire it again. Normally two or three firings takes care of most of our designs. Right. Some designs only take one. We can do the entire thing, layer all the colors on, and just fire it once. It really depends. Like on the cedar waxwing, she makes it white first. A lot of the things we do, we actually put a white base on it first. because that makes a lot of the colors pop. It's kind of like some cars, they paint them white first, and then they put, like, a lot of show cars, they paint them white, because it makes, you know, reds pop and blues pop and that kind of thing, so.
But she was doing the birds with glass.
Yeah.
She was using a stencil.
Right. Yeah, so that's how all this is done. So we lay a stencil over this, mm-hmm. and that's how we get all the different browns to go exactly where. But all the stencils, kind of like making molds, we cut all the stencils here.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're not purchased. Everything's done here. So we made the kiln. I mean, so we don't. This is not off the shelf. We just I fixed this on the door broke on Wednesday. I said we're having the tour, so I came in at 6 o'clock on Thursday morning. I took the whole door off. We repacked all the insulation. I mean, we're kind of one of those companies where you just do it. Do you know what I mean? You figure it out as you're doing things, so. Say that again, I'm sorry.
Colors.
Yes, they're all actually in, this is our bulk powder, all these white jars. You'll notice the language is in a different language. We order it in kilos, it comes from Limoges, France. And then the powders behind you are from a U.S. company, so yeah, we actually purchase it in a ground powder form.
It's glass, right?
It's glass. So we have a great video on our website from this manufacturer that actually shows how they make it. It's very, very cool because it's actually molten glass. So they actually bake it in a crucible. Excuse me, if I can talk today. And then they scoop it out in ladles and lay it on a table. And then the molten glass sits there and cools, and they take the glass and they smash it into smaller glass pieces, and then it goes into ball mills and they grind it up into what we get sent here. But it's colored, tinted glass, and then they grind it down to a certain mesh size that we spec it out to. So this is actually what's called a 80 mesh, which means it fits through an 80 mesh screen. All right, so it's glass. So yeah, so it goes from glass down to a ground up to a powder. We shake the powder on, fire it back to a solid glass again. Yep. So yeah. So you'll notice as I'm jabbing them on here, we've gone back to where it is, and it's warm, but it's almost cooled off. So.
And if you have to add another color or another firing,
yep.
It
will not, no. So, all right, I'm going to sneak around the outside here, and we're going to follow me over to the welding area. Thank you, Fon. All right, come on down here.
I'm going to get behind just so for the voice.
Sure.
But I'll stay here. I don't know.
You might want to go. I'm not going to talk.
Sorry.
Diane's going to talk.
Okay.
Come on down here, we're gonna have Diane talk
here. We're just filming this for our public TV lab. Just get your voice in there.
Oh, okay, when I start talking.
Yeah.
So this is Diane, and she's gonna talk to you about how we attach all of our pieces and our final welding process and how we make all of our frames.
Alrighty. Bend this around one more time, yeah?
Quiet.
Hello. We have a little weld shop, brazing shop here. You can see all these benches and different torches. And we do a lot of different kinds of design, assembly, creation, and we have lots of different, because we use different materials, we've adopted a bunch of techniques and learned them over the years, and still are learning. You'll notice that we have some very small pieces that are little songbird pieces and flower pieces that are mostly the frames are there just to show off the enamels. And sometimes, you know, we need a little artful little twig or a branch to show off those enamels, and then things get bigger and bigger until we're doing trees, you know, great big things like that. Also, sunbursts. I don't know if we have any sunbursts around today, but so we don't. Yeah, Yeah. Oh, that's a piece of one, yeah. Anyway, so we usually will do is have, basically we have a line, a product line that we develop, and it morphs over the years or it changes depending on, well, first of all, a lot of the shows and trade shows we go to, sort of we gather lots of ideas. Mm-hmm. We see what sells and what doesn't, just like anyone would. And we try new things. A lot of the craft shows are great because then we actually can see what will sell. We're not going through a shop to do it. Anyway, so we have to do really intricate assembly, you know, tiny little flowers where they're half an inch apart. We don't burn ourselves very often. And then
we learn quickly.
or you go do some other job. Anyway, a lot of our work lately has been catering to people who want a special piece, a custom piece. They have a big wall, a place, something over their mantle or next to their door, and they want something that we don't quite have to fit in that space. But they like what we do, and they'll work with us, and we'll work with them to make something. And that's what a tree, this big tree here, is. Someone wanted a big autumn tree that would fit in. Basically, I was working on that earlier. Here's my space. They said 44 by 38 or something like that. And that was freehand. Yes, I have this drawing, but that one was an earlier freehand, smaller one. This one was bigger. So this kind of a piece, we don't have pre-cut parts. We just cut the parts out. So I had to make this, a little tracer. Anyway. Custom pieces require the fact that I've had a lot of experience making little trees of all sizes and branches and pieces. There's a little bit of experience involved knowing just what moves to make. But after that is done, see, there's a small version of a little branch. You know, all that copper is shaped by hand with various little tools and wires and pieces that I can use to create a texture. All that, all this is copper tubing, you know, that you would probably get from the plumbing supply store. And we also do things in steel, so steel branches that are made differently than that, but basically the same idea.
So is it all solder?
It's not really, it's sort of a hybrid. It's like in between a, if you're familiar with a brazing rod, you know, the which is a, it's like a kind of a brazing rod that refrigeration plumbing people use for certain applications, and it's really good for putting copper to copper.
So do you have to like sand it afterwards, or is it just put it on and that's it?
Put it on, that's it. You don't even need it, you know.
You don't have to.
No, well, it most of the well, you know, these are pretty organic things. They're branches, so whether there's a, you know, a little rough join there, it looks pretty natural, you know. So no, there's no need to do that. That's pretty much it. I mean, happy to talk about technical things if anyone wants to stop by on their way, you know. But mostly, right now, Bhavano is about trying to create new items, freshen up things every year. Often it's generated by customer ideas, challenge us to try other things. We also will throw a few out of on our own. A lot of the customs drive new designs because they're often a challenge. Some people are asking things that are something we haven't even tried to do before. So that's what's fun about these times for Bhavano, is that we have a lot of challenges to meet, and there's a lot more one-off pieces and that sort of thing. Yeah.
So if you're going to do a custom piece like that, how much time does it take you to do that?
It's a difficult thing. I never made that tree before. When I started this morning, there were no leaves on it, and I was explaining to the first people that I had never seen the frame with leaves on it. So I guess I said, Sharon, I need maybe 120 leaves. And it actually came out perfect. But I was just lucky, you know. I couldn't, maybe Monday I'd ask her to make me 15 more, you know. And but then I might look at the shape, and I might, it's actually, I won't decide whether I'm happy until Monday. I'll come back in and get fresh eyes on it, you know.
Well, what would you consider to be something that you wouldn't be happy with? I mean, it looks stunning the way it is.
Well, yeah, your feedback is making me just back away from you.
Sorry about that.
I think it looks horrible. You should try that one all over again. I'll take the one.
Yeah.
We don't really have this many critics, so yeah.
Yeah. No, we have a customer for this, and
It's being built for someone.
For someone.
Awesome.
And we're going to take a photo, and I keep track of it. Basically, what I'm doing is I'm getting an opportunity to do new design work, but it's actually a sold piece. So that's a plus. It's a lot of money spent. If they said, Diane, let's just spend a whole week doing design work, well then that's a big cost to soak up in the business. So and there are times when we do that, but. This is kind of creates more of a flow in how we're doing things. We're producing things, designing things, and all in one kind of thing. You know.
May I ask what your background is?
Well, I've been here so long. I guess this is my background.
That's true with everybody.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I do this kind of work also on my own, but not quite the same work because it's something different, and you know. I never went to art school, if that's what you know. I got interested in metalsmithing. I was a music student, came to Bovano to work part-time just while I was at school, and gradually got more and more into it. I learned a lot on the job, and I had some people before me that taught me their things. And then I also learned some things on my own that I brought in, and it's all... And it's not just me, it's other people here that feed things through together. And Sharon, of course, hasn't gone to school for enameling years ago, and she's quite an expert. People call from all over the world to ask her questions about using the enamels that we represent sometimes. So it's kind of like that. Jim and Kevin and do a lot of work getting, you know, we often have the customers or the people come right here to talk to us. They communicate ideas and help interpret ideas to us. So there's a conduit where everyone kind of gets involved. And I feel like I just kept talking, but I don't know if I answered the question.
Very informative.
Any other questions or in the spot?
For that piece, we saw the technique for the leaves, but the tree branches are, it's like a different finish, like almost a matte finish. Is that a different?
It's not, that's no. Just copper right now.
Oh.
That's just 100% copper trunk. The coloration of it is copper. The color of the trunk is just, it's essentially torch fired. That's just what happens when you heat copper with a oxyacetylene torch.
So in a couple of years, will that be green?
It depends on where you put it.
Probably not.
Yeah.
Because it would if it was really in a humid place, and it could.
If,
but all
if
the
you
fact
have a beach house on the Jersey Shore and you put it outside?
Yeah.
Put it in Arizona, it would just stay red.
Yeah.
But we actually do patinaing. You see some of our trees have patina leaves. But we do sort of have a secret little process to accelerate what you would get if you left your stuff out for 20 years or something to get that look. So we do that, but the enamels create the shine and the color. We put a little finish on this. This isn't finished yet. That gives it a little bit of a satin shine at the end. I do that after it's all set and ready to go, and everything's checked.
Oh,
All right, we're going to go to the other side of the room over here. Talk about one more thing. So remember earlier that we were talking about we have our Kanban cards. So this is another Kanban card. This is the very last step of that card. You'll see all the components here have all been welded, and they're all ready to go. So this is where we do all of our final assembly. This is another frame. Obviously, it's going to get a sea turtle on it here. But so this is where we'll do all of our final gluing. We epoxy most of our parts. So we'll take a epoxy gun like this, and we don't have any nozzles out here. This is a used one, but we'll put a two-part nozzle on here, and we'll put a little bit of epoxy in all the parts. And in this case, the little turtle will go on there. We'll put a magnet on there to keep them where we want it to go. That'll dry in about 15 or 20 minutes. We used to use a very special hot melt glue. We used it for about 30 years, actually. We loved it. It worked great and set up fast. It was impossible to get the piece off of it. About 6 months ago, 3M said, "We're sorry, we're not going to make this product anymore." So we spent about 2 weeks of extensive testing with three manufacturers and a couple of different reps, and we finally found a very special two-part epoxy that works even better than our 3M hot melt ever did. So we've just recently switched over to this. We're very, very happy with it. So that's what happens, and then every single piece that we make, and when I say every single piece, I mean every single piece, gets hung on this little tiny hook right here. And you'll notice that this board is kind of scratched back and forth. We will literally put every single piece, regardless of the dollar amount, except for maybe that big tree over there, and hang it on this hook. And we will knock on the board, and that piece will kind of center itself and hang back and forth. And we'll make sure that that piece hangs exactly the way that we want it to. Birds will hang the right way. If it doesn't, we'll take it off, we'll bend the hook. You'll notice on some of our pieces it has a hook on a stem. Sometimes when you flip it over, the stem will be bent crooked or upside down. That's because we bent it like that in order to get the piece to hang the correct way. It's not a hook that's made out of like a paper clip that if you bend back and forth, it's a special wire that we've used in order to make it hang like that. So that's why, actually, here's one right here. So see this little hook, how it looks like it's crooked? Well, when we welded this piece, it was probably straight out like that, okay? But when we hung the piece, we probably had to do that to it, okay? It's just so we could weld it on there straight to make it easier for welding it, but when we hang it, we had to bend it in order to get it to hang right, in order to get it to balance right. So that's that. And we do that so that when you get it home, the $125 that you spend on this piece that has our name on the back of it looks exactly the way that we wanted it to look, and exactly the way that your money that you spent on our piece should look perfect on your wall, so, or the gift that you gave to somebody or something like that. So that really ends the tour today. Does anybody have any questions and anything that you saw? Yes?
You said you put a magnet on top of it to hold it?
We do, yeah.
The copper does a magnet?
The disc that it goes on top of is steel. Oh. So the magnet's holding through the copper onto the steel underneath it. So, and it just needs to sit there for about 15 minutes or so while it's while the epoxy's curing. So,
I got a question on the durability of the piece itself.
Yeah.
If it's on a wall and if for some reason someone hit it and it falls off,
sure,
falls on a cement floor, will it shatter?
It will crack. Yeah.
It will crack.
And you can send it back to us and we'll fix it. Because
you can fix it.
Yep. If this were to crack, the glass would probably craze on here. You bring it back, we do have ways of getting the epoxy back off, which is really a lot of heat. You just duplicate the surface of the sun, and that will release the two-part epoxy, and we have to scrape it all off, and we can add new glass. We can put the old stencil on top of it and shake on new glass with the old pattern, right? Put it back in the kiln, and it'll heat the new glass in the kiln. It'll heat up the new glass and the old glass, and the two will fuse together. You would never know that it was cracked on there. So, yeah. We do several repairs every single week. In fact, that's what this box is here. It's somebody's piece that they sent back to us that's being repaired.
Do you have work on?
Yeah. Anybody else? No? Yeah, we purposely welded little bumps on there to make it look like a little piece of coral. Yeah.